Every week, Hillsdale College President Larry P. Arnn joins Hugh Hewitt to discuss great books, great men, and great ideas. This is the Hillsdale Dialogues, part of the Hillsdale College Podcast Network. More episodes at podcast.hillsdale.edu or wherever you find your audio. Also at the Hillsdale College Podcast Network, check out the Radio Free Hillsdale Hour, the Hillsdale College K-12 Classical Education Podcast, the Larry P. Arnn Show, and more, all at podcast.hillsdale.edu.
Morning glory, America. Bonjour, hi, Canada. I'm Hugh Hewitt. That music means it's the last radio hour of the week for my new affiliates, about 450 and rising in the Florida Keys, and in Cape May, New Jersey. Every last hour is devoted to the Hillsdale Dialogue, where we go big and we talk about big issues and big people and big ideas, usually with Dr. Larry Arnn, president of Hillsdale College. All things Hillsdale, you can find at hillsdale.edu, and you can find all of the Hillsdale Dialogues, 508 of them, at hughforhillsdale.com. Dr. Arnn is unavailable today. So I went back into the archives, and we have an encore presentation of our conversation about the Cooper Union speech by Abraham Lincoln. I brought this out because of Cooper Union being in the news this week with Jewish students trapped in the library, told to hide in the attic as anti-Semitic demonstrators threatened them. And I thought to when Abraham Lincoln laid down one of the most significant speeches in American history at Cooper Union. So let's begin with this encore presentation of the Hillsdale Dialogue with Dr. Larry Arnn. Up now to February 27th of 1860. Dr. Arnn, welcome back. Of course, we're talking about the Cooper Union address today.
It's a wonderful thing to talk about, Hugh.
The party of Lincoln does not seem to be today where it was in 1858 to 1860, does it?
Well, when has it ever been since then, except maybe in the 1980s? Well, I guess Calvin Coolidge is really good, too.
Yeah.
But, yeah, the debate format is terrible, and some of them will distinguish themselves, I think, and I hope. It's a better field than we've had in recent elections, and so there's promise in that. But somebody needs to tell the story in a powerful way, as Lincoln did in the debates and in the speeches we're going to talk about today. And, you know, there's a lot of interest in politics. And, you know, at Hillsdale and on your show, we get people who pay enormous attention for hours at a time. But, you know, on our online courses and all kinds of things like that, at events we hold. But the national attention needs to reach that point. And it's chopped up by the media in crazy ways. And we have to break through that. Of course, one way to break through that is to be the nominee, because then you're going to get a lot of attention all over the country. And in recent years, since Reagan, I argue, our nominees have not made the best of that, even the ones who won.
Reagan made a lot of great speeches, and he used the format of his speech. I know you are counselor to many and endorser of none in the Republican field. Are you counseling them to seek out? Are you counseling a lot of Republicans to try and create that sort of a venue of the sort that we're going to talk about now with Lincoln?
Yeah, I am very much, of course. And then also, I'm telling them that the ones I talk to, that they should make the equivalent of the House Divided speech. They should say that this generation of Americans has to choose between two alternative forms of government. And the one form, the one that's increasingly installed, is powerful and hard to resist and promises the moon. But I think that it leads down the road to despotism. I think they should make that case and set the general election up for a debate about that. And then there would be real focus.
I hope people are listening to this. Now, let's go to where we left off last week. Lincoln loses the election after seven extraordinary debates with Judge Douglas. What happens to him after the election, and how does he come to be at the Cooper Union on February 27th of 1860? And originally, I think he was supposed to go to Henry Ward Beecher's church in Brooklyn. He ended up at Cooper Union, which is a college. Can you kind of fill us in before we get to the night that he takes the stage?
Well, when 1859 dawns, things are getting more political in the country, right? And so the field is starting to form, and Lincoln gets this invitation to go back east. He gave six speeches. I looked it up back there, and they had dramatic effects. And Lincoln had never been there before, and they had never seen him before. And the Cooper Union was the first of them and had the most dramatic impact, although they all did. If we have time today, I'm going to tell you a great story, one of my favorite things about Lincoln. So this goes through 1859, and then in 1860, Lincoln is invited to the Cooper Union and the Hartford and several places back east. He gives these speeches, big crowds and lots of press coverage. And in general, so, you know, we're in February of 1860, and those speeches were over by the end of the first week in March. The Republican convention is in May in Chicago. And Lincoln's a candidate now after these speeches are over. And then the Democratic convention is later in May, the first one. No, June, I'm sorry, in June. And that one is in Charleston, South Carolina. And that one breaks up in dissent. And the party splits. They try again in Baltimore. Another group split off. They had a second one, so that makes three total in Baltimore. All this is happening in late June. And they end up, the Democrats nominate a bunch of candidates out of their thing. But the Republicans unite behind Lincoln. And I'll just tell that story real quick. It was in the Wigwam, a big, huge a wood building built for the purpose, all out in Chicago, a political coup for Lincoln's supporters, because it's in Lincoln State. Not a hard coup to make, because they need to carry Chicago,
yep.
And it's possible they can do it. And they know that in part because of the Republican performance in the 1858 election. And so on the first ballot, they're all for Seward of New York, but not enough to get the nomination. There's evidence that Lincoln understood that that would be what would happen. And he went campaigning, but he didn't go to the convention. He sent people, led by a man named David Davis. And his instruction to them was, wait for the second ballot and build support. And Lincoln won on the third ballot, and not by a huge amount over Seward, but he won. And one of his instructions to his managers, and see, he wasn't in the town. He was down in Springfield, although they were in telegraph communication. He said, make no deals, I've looked all this up to get the story right, that bind me. That was his last instruction to them. They were not allowed to make any deals. And at the end of this, I'll tell you the one that he made. Davis made it. I might have mentioned this before, but I misspoke who made it. The one that I said made it was the beneficiary of the deal. Well, I'll just tell it real quick. Make no deals that bind me. Lincoln needed Pennsylvania. And the big man from Pennsylvania was Simon Cameron. And he had a reputation. Thaddeus Stevens, a senator, abolitionist senator, said once, and in front of Lincoln and Simon Cameron, he wouldn't steal a red hot stove. And Cameron acted like he was going to challenge him a duel, said, I demand that you take that back. And Stevens said, okay, you would steal it. Well, David Davis made a deal on Lincoln's behalf and without his authority to appoint Simon Cameron to the War Department, which he did, and he lasted a year and was dismissed for crooked dealings and making money off the government. So that was a heck of a thing. But now go back to Cooper Union. Lincoln's ability to command votes in the East comes in part from his resume from Illinois and his Lincoln-Douglas debates, but also from the effect of these speeches, especially the Cooper Union speech.
And I'm amazed by the intrigue going on here. First of all, we should all pray for the fervent dissolution of the Democratic Party into factions as we speak. It would be a wonderful thing if they had three or four candidates in 2016 and not just 1860. Not likely to happen. The other is, though, that he would counsel such patience, and he was a very patient guy and very, I want to use the word cunning in its highest sense. He was a very effective politician, Larry Arnn, not just a statesman, but a very effective politician.
He was a shrewd son. Well, he showed it in the war later. He was a shrewd war leader. But if you think, Lincoln won the 40% of the vote in the 1860 election, but that looks like he's a bad plurality president. But the truth is, there were several southern states where his votes were not even counted. And second, if you add up the electoral votes of everybody on the ballot against Lincoln, he still would have won by a large majority in the Electoral College.
That's amazing. Now, we turn to the speech that got this all started, the Cooper Union speech, and I want to read it before the break, just the first three paragraphs. It begins, "Mr. President and fellow citizens of New York, the facts with which I shall deal this evening are mainly old and familiar, nor is there anything new in the general use I shall make of them. If there be any novelty, it will be made in the presenting of the facts, the inferences and observations following that presentation. In his speech last autumn at Columbus, as reported in the New York Times, Senator Douglas said, 'Our founders, when they framed the government under which we live, understood this question just as well and even better than we do now.'" I read that only to say it's a continuation of the Lincoln-Douglas debates, Larry Arnn.
Exactly so.
It is exactly so. Hugh Hewitt back live now. When we come back, I just keep in mind Cooper Union, the site of one of the greatest, most significant speeches in American history by Abraham Lincoln, was the site this week of an anti-Semitic mob trapping Jewish students in its library. That's quite the contrast. No word on the main killer. No additional news from Israel other than a Tel Aviv rocket attack. It hit an apartment building there. I'll keep updating you on the news, and I'll be back with Dr. Arnn right after this on The Hugh Hewitt Show.
Hillsdale College is a small, Christian, classical liberal arts college that operates independently of government funding. And we want you or your son or daughter to apply. At Hillsdale, students grow in heart and mind by studying timeless truths in a supportive community dedicated to the highest things. Hillsdale College costs significantly less than other nationally ranked private liberal arts colleges and receives regular recognition as a best value, and nearly all students receive financial aid. Our robust core curriculum, vibrant student life, and 8-to-1 student-to-faculty ratio make for an education like no other. For more information or to fill out an application, visit hillsdale.edu/info. That's hillsdale.edu/info.
Welcome back, America, with Dr. Arnn, unavailable today for the Hillsdale Dialogue. I have reached into our archive to bring up our conversation from years ago about Cooper Union, much in the news this week as its Jewish students were threatened and had to hide in the library from an anti-Semitic mob on the campus of Cooper Union, where Lincoln held forth in 1860. Let's go back to my conversation with Dr. Arnn. All of the Hillsdale Dialogues available at hughforhillsdale.com. You thought we were done with the Lincoln-Douglas debates, only to find out that even though the election was over for the Senate in Illinois, the presidential election immediately resumed, and Abraham Lincoln begins his campaign, in essence, at the Cooper Union by quoting Judge Douglas. I actually had forgotten that, Larry Arnn, until I went back and read this.
Well, it's brilliant, and I don't know how much of you want to read, but the speech begins with an intellectual achievement. He takes this thing and he says, "I agree with Douglas. I'm going to take as my text his assertion that those who framed the government understood this question just as well or even better than we do now." And so then he asked the question, what did they do? What did they do about the power of the federal government to forbid slavery in the federal territory?
They being the founders. They being the men of 1787.
Specifically, the 39 members of the Constitutional Convention who signed the document.
Yeah.
And so he traces all 39. And he finds, I mean, if you should read it, he finds that 23 of them actually cast votes in their career on the question slavery in the federal territories. And 21 of them voted to confine, forbid or restrict slavery in the territories. That's a majority of the 39. Then he finds two who voted against those things. And see, this is Lincoln, the Euclidean reasoner, right?
And lawyer.
But those are different things.
Yes.
But he says those two may have voted no for expediency. We don't know. We don't know if they voted no on constitutional grounds, whereas the 21, we know they had to think it was constitutional, else they violated their oath. Then he says there are 16 who never cast any vote at all on it, but we know that several on that question, but we know that several of them were leading abolitionists. And so the truth is, and, you know, one of the 21, by the way, was Charles Pinckney from South Carolina.
Yep.
So Lincoln says, we actually have their testimony and more, because in the summer they were writing the Constitution. The Northwest Ordinance was passed that forbade slavery to go into the Northwest Territory, which is a wonderful place where I live, and Ohio happens to be in there too, although not important.
It was the capital thereof.
Yeah, and so Lincoln says, they and then those 21 voted to implement the Northwest Ordinance, and it was from the same month of the Constitution. So he makes a case that if you take Douglass's word as gospel, that they knew as well or better than we do, we know what they thought. And it's just, and so that part of the speech, it opens with that piece of scholarship is really what it is. And he spent weeks, you know, working as a lawyer all the time, getting ready for this and putting that point together. And it sort of matches the scholarship he did for the Peoria speech, where he traced all the movements of slavery across America and was able to clarify those for people, so that you could see that it's only recently that people are saying it should be expanded because it's good.
And the hammer that he uses is Judge Douglas's own statement that we should trust the framers on this subject. That's what he shatters the Democratic Party with. And that's why Cooper Union matters even to this day in 2015 from 1860 forward. What did the framers think? Okay, that's what they think is important. Let's go find out. And very Scalia-like, he does.
And think how politically, because you made this point before, politically shrewd it is, because Douglas is likely to be the nominee. And everybody's thinking about Douglas. And by starting with Douglas, Lincoln is reminding them that he just argued with that guy seven times.
Yeah, yeah.
And he takes him on at the beginning, see? And so it's the equivalent is this. Imagine, then, that Hillary Clinton, or whoever the nominee is going to be, I think that's in some doubt now, has made it the touchstone of her politics for 30 years that X is true. And so one of these guys who's running for the Republican nomination says, let's take that for gospel. Let me show you why nothing she does is legitimated by it. That's what Lincoln does. In other words, he shows that he can defeat him in his central argument. And that is obviously, in a profound sense, a campaign speech.
And he also summons up the ghost of George Washington. I want people to understand the art of this. Not only does he get to the 39 framers, he goes to the framer of the framers, man, who presided over the convention and who brought the country together and who actually won its liberty. And he invokes Washington to devastating effect.
That's right, because Washington signed the implementation legislation for the Northwest Ordinance, and he was, as you say, chairman of the commission of the Constitutional Convention, and he was on public record as an opponent of slavery, and he liberated his slaves upon his death. And so that massive thing, see, and so he, it's not just so the logical point is he takes Douglass's own assertion and uses it to prove his case. And then the moral point comes in, because what are we going to do, chop up George Washington? It's only in our day that we started to do that.
I'm coming right back, America. Hugh for Hillsdale.com. The Encore presentation from 2015 continues. Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. No update from Maine. No sight, excuse me, of the killer. No pressing breaking news from Israel. The war continues. I am in the middle of the Hillsdale Dialogue, an encore presentation, which we do when Dr. Arnn is not available, and there is a pressing need to replay one of our 508 previous Hillsdale Dialogues. This one from 2015 or early 2016 has to do with the Cooper Union speech delivered by Abraham Lincoln in 1860, and I pulled it out of the archive for today with Dr. Arnn indisposed because it is so on point to contrast what happened at Cooper Union when Lincoln spoke there in 1860 with what happened at Cooper Union this week, where Jewish students were threatened by an anti-Semitic mob and locked in the library and told to go to the attic, which is, it's not ironic, it's disgusting. But Cooper Union has fallen on hard times. But let's go back to the good times. 1860, Abraham Lincoln, my conversation with Dr. Larry Arnn. Remember, all things Hillsdale at hillsdale.edu and every Hillsdale dialogue at hugh4hillsdale.com.
Does Douglas even know this is coming, by the way? This is a bit of political history I don't know anything about. Does Douglas know he's about to be broadsided at Cooper Union? And with all the world's press in New York, like today, it was then the center of the press world.
He would have, I don't know the answer to that, but we know what Douglas did, by the way. Douglas is actually the first person to campaign for president of the United States having a party nomination. He had, you know, two-thirds of a party nomination. And he campaigned relentlessly all across the country on the same principles that that he had used in the Lincoln-Douglas debates. And he campaigned extensively in the South, where he was received with wide hostility. And he exhausted himself doing that. And he didn't get any votes doing it. In the South, he carried some states, but he tried to keep on. And at the end, you know, I've told the story on during the debates. At the end, after Lincoln was elected, he met with Lincoln and pledged him his support, and said to Lincoln that he'd been trying to keep the Union together. And Lincoln replied that he knew that.
See, that's you did make that point. Maybe someone mentioned it. It's astonishing, though, at the end that Judge Douglas would try and cop that plea. Do you believe him sincerely, Larry, that he was trying to keep the Union together?
Oh, yeah. I believe it's central in the same reason, but the same reason that I believe modern liberalism, which, in my opinion, now in government is doing things that are lawless and threaten to overwhelm the people of the country. I also believe, however, that they are doing those things because they believe in them with all their heart. And they believe that if we will use the tools of science and scientific administration, it's the only way to create a better world or even cope with the problems that science has produced so far. In other words, like Douglas, they have a case and they believe in it. And the tragedy for the Republic is that their case is not adequately engaged.
Larry Arnn, the president of Hillsdale College, hillsdale.edu. While you are there, getting any of their free courses on the Constitution of the Progressive Movement or signing up for Imprimis, their free speech digest, or over at hugh4hillsdale.com, where all of the Hillsdale dialogues are collected, take time to acquaint yourself with the college and encourage young people in the season of application to investigate this outpost of liberty, this lantern of liberty up in the north, even though it's cold there in the wintertime. Dr. Arnn, what's amazing about the Cooper Union, again, I had forgotten this, it's very current. He talks about John Brown. He does not hesitate to go right at the heart of what is plaguing the country. It's not full of cliche. He's dealing with the real problems of the country and the agony it's going through.
That's right. And he takes, so John Brown, if people should know, was an abolitionist from Kansas who seized Harper's Ferry and tried to foment a rebellion. And, of course, it was Robert E. Lee who commanded the troops that destroyed his little insurrection. And, of course, the South, Lincoln says in this speech, the pro-slavery Confederate leaders, or eventual Confederate leaders, they seized upon this as the cause of the Republicans. They're going to lead to insurrection and lawlessness in their passion to get rid of slavery. And Lincoln repudiates that in this speech. He says, and the argument is interesting on contemporary grounds for another reason.
Yes.
He says, first of all, we didn't do that. Nobody identified with the Republican Party is identified in any of these slave revolts and anything like John Brown. And we protest constantly that we don't even favor that. We protest in action because we take the position we have no power under the Constitution to abolish slavery in the states where it exists. And in his first inaugural, a year later now than this, Lincoln says, and indeed, although it would be redundant, if you want to amend the Constitution to say that, I will not resist it. So, and he says, but all of these actions are no good. And even if we refrain from saying anything about the abolition of slavery in the states where it exists, that's not enough for you. You will not be satisfied with us until you agree that it is a good thing.
Yep. Now tell me its application.
We will be railed against and humiliated unless we will agree with you that slavery is good. And, you know, people who don't like some of the things going on today because of religion or conscience, they meet pressure like that.
That is the, I wanted you to go to the contemporary parallel, whether it is same-sex marriage, whether it is abortion, whether it is any of the issues categorized under social issues, whether it's the war in Iraq, whether it's a national defense. You Will Be Made to Agree is actually the title of a book by a friend of mine. And End of Discussion is another book that's out there. The Silencing is another book that's out there. They're all making the same point. The left is not content with winning. You must agree.
That's right. And so to live on your own, practicing your principles and your faith, that's the point. There's pressure about that. And Lincoln, so the beginning of the speech is a logical analysis, which, however, has the brilliant effect of placing him as the chief opponent to Frederick Douglass, which he's won the right to do by being from the same state and debating him.
Stephen Douglass, not Frederick Douglass. Stephen Douglass.
Did I say Frederick?
Yes, you did.
Stephen. Yep. And the second, the end of the speech is a fighting speech. And the introduction to it is a statement of moderation. We Republicans should not do anything violent. We should not use any violent words. We should make our arguments in reason. And then he says, however, they will never be satisfied until we agree, and we must proclaim that we do not agree. And we must proclaim that loudly. And, you know, the last sentences of the speech are, of course, famous. Do you want to read those now?
Let's wait till after the break because we'll run out of time. What I want to read before the break is where he turns over to the attack speech. He says, a few words now to Republicans. It is exceedingly desirable that all parts of this great Confederacy shall be at peace and in harmony one with another. Let us Republicans do our part to have it so. Even though much provoked, let us do nothing through passion and ill temper. Even though the Southern people will not as so much as listen to us, let us calmly consider their demands and yield to them if, in our deliberate view of our duty, we possibly can. Judging by all they say and do and by the subject and nature of their controversy with us, let us determine if we can what will satisfy them. That's the appeal for moderation you're talking about, Dr.
That's right. That's right.
I
counseled somebody in politics lately. I said, you must couple two things together because they make peace together. And one of them is you should be adamant in principle and you should be moderate in practice.
And in tone. We're talking about the speech that launched Lincoln's presidential campaign in 1860 that led to the White House, which led to the Civil War, which led to the abolition of slavery. What was the close that you were referring to, Larry? Why don't you read that for the audience, and then let's talk about what it means.
These are immortal words, right? The speech ends this. It's after the part about how we'll never be left in peace until we agree. Neither let us be slandered from our duty by false accusation against us, nor frightened from it by menaces of destruction to the government, nor of dungeons to ourselves. So it's kind of martyrdom, right? Let us have faith that might makes right, and in that faith, let us to the end dare to do our duty as we understand it. That's how it closes.
It's really impassioned, and it electrified the crowd, correct?
That's right. The reactions to this are tremendous, and people, the accounts generally run this way. At first, he looked awkward, and his voice was unpleasantly high, and people stirred around thinking this is going to be boring. And then the best article about it names a place in the third paragraph, and then he made that point, and all of a sudden, everyone was rapt. And then the whole, you could hear a pin drop, and there's a description of how he did his hands. He stood still, his hands were sort of like boards, down by his side, and during the course of the speech, they gradually came up. So his hands were parallel with his head by the time he finished. And one person describes how his body moved with the words, but imperceptibly, never violently, and yet the cadence of it all got right into the crowd, and they were all just hanging and swaying with him. And that, you see, that was genius, right? And that meant now There's something more than a calculation that he can win. There's also love. They want that thing. They want that to lead the country. And that, it doesn't just mean that man. The whole being of the man includes the words that he was saying. And so it was just galvanizing.
Let's go back to that last line. Let us have faith that right makes might, And in that faith, let us to that end dare to do our duty as we understand it. That presumes that we can know what right is, Larry Arnn.
That's right. And also, Lincoln's attack on Douglas in the Lincoln-Douglas debates, Churchill had a favorite phrase that he used once about Stanley Baldwin. He said, "That's too easy to be good." So Douglas was not asking anybody to do anything except just what they wanted to do. And Lincoln says, that just boils down to the principle of self-interest. And what it liberates is the old thing from the serpent in the Garden of Eden. You eat, you work, and I'll eat.
Yeah.
And that, you see, in other words, there's a moral judgment in there. And Lincoln's point is not, I have this brilliant insight into absolute truth. His point is something else. We have nothing to guide us except our sense of right, and we all have that.
And we all know that what happened at Cooper Union this week was not right, but deeply evil. Therefore, I'm replaying this conversation with Dr. Arnn in the Encore presentation of the Hillsdale Dialogue. All things Hillsdale can be found at hughforhillsdale.com, all the Hillsdale Dialogues, all 508 of them. And application to or subscription for Imprimis, absolutely free, are found at hillsdale.edu, as are all of the video courses. They are a great sponsor, and Dr. Arnn, of course, has been my friend for 40 years. Please go to hughforhillsdale.com, and I'll be right back on the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Hey, it's Scott Bertram, and I've got a challenge for you today. Become a better educated American citizen. And to help you do just that, we at Hillsdale College have our free online courses available for all who wish to learn. Our challenge? Take just one of our courses. There are so many to choose from. You can discover the beauty of the Bible in the Genesis story, study the writings of C.S. Lewis, or explore the true meaning of America in Constitution 101. We have dozens more to choose from, and all these self-paced free courses feature Hillsdale faculty and scholars, many you've heard on this podcast. So visit hillsdale.edu/course, C-O-U-R-S-E, and pick one of the more than 30 free Hillsdale courses. I hope you'll accept my challenge. Pick whichever course you like and become a more educated citizen today. Go to hillsdale.edu/course, C-O-U-R-S-E. That's hillsdale.edu/course.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. No arrest in Maine yet as Israel prepares to invade Gaza. No beginning of the invasion yet. I will keep you posted. Let's go to the conclusion of my encore presentation of the Hillsdale Dialogue on the Cooper Union speech with Dr. Larry Arnn, Abraham Lincoln's famous 1860 speech at Cooper Union. The university in the news this week because its Jewish students, a number of them, were threatened by an anti-Semitic mob, locked in the library, told to hide in the attic. That is not the Cooper Union that Lincoln addressed. Here's Dr. Arnn.
Now, very few people I could make this jump this quickly with, but I can with Dr. Arnn. In 1835, there was an election in Great Britain. I had occasion to go back and read the Conservative Manifesto from 1935. Do you know it doesn't mention Hitler? It does not mention Hitler. It is oblivious. It talks about the League of Nations and the need to cut armaments expenditure and things like that. And I thought to myself, that's an impoverished political. They avoided the central issue of their time. And I think there's some who would like to run this campaign the same way.
That's right. And see, that was the low watermark in the life of Winston Churchill, maybe the political career, because they snookered him and for two more years, really. But after that election, Churchill began gathering strength, and he was the best show in the House of Commons, and people were attending to him and going to his events, and he began to be able to put pressure on the Conservative Party, of which he was a member, and they began to have to listen to him. So by 1936, they're beginning to pay lip service to rearmament and doing some of it.
It's remarkable to me that those who go direct at the central issue inevitably do at least engage the opponents in the argument. Let me ask you, after Cooper Union, you said he goes on a speaking tour where it's very heavily publicized. Is he ever not running for president after this moment?
No, certainly not. And, of course, you know, the campaign is, I mean, the convention is 2 weeks away. You know, I don't know if we have time, but in response to a journalist in New Haven, Lincoln, how much time do we have?
We have 2.5 minutes.
Okay, I think I can do it. In New Haven, Connecticut, Lincoln mentioned this argument. He said, if I see a rattlesnake, it depends on where it is, what I do. If it's out in a field, I'll get a stick and kill it. But what if the rattlesnake is in bed with my children? You know, that, and this is slavery in the Constitution, right?
Yep.
The children of the Constitution. Then what I do is less certain. I may not disturb the snake for fear it will bite the children, and it might just go away. You see? So the next day he's on a train platform with a journalist, and this will explain something about the greatness of Abraham Lincoln, and I read this to young people all the time, but politicians too. This journalist says to him, how did you think of that? What was your education like? And he said, well, it wasn't much. He said, but reading law, I kept coming across the word demonstrate. And I thought at first, so I'm now reading a quote from this newspaper article describing what Lincoln said, I thought at first that I understood its meaning, but soon became satisfied that I did not. What do I mean when I demonstrate more than when I reason or prove? How does demonstration differ from any other proof? I consulted Webster. Certain proof, he says. I thought a great many things were proved beyond a possibility of doubt without recourse to any such extraordinary process of reasoning. And so I said to myself, Lincoln, you will never make a lawyer if you do not understand what demonstrates means. And I left my situation in Springfield, went home to my father's house, and stayed there till I could give any proposition in the 6 books of Euclid at sight. I then found out what demonstrate means and went back to my law studies. How many politicians have done that?
I don't know. That's not the best ad for students who want to go to Hillsdale College. You've got to go memorize Euclid. Dr. Larry Arnn, always a pleasure. They still teach Euclid at Hillsdale, by the way. Go get your application. One of the last sane colleges in the United States. No, hopefully by this time tomorrow, the killer in Maine will be apprehended, and we will know more about the hostages and about Israel, and I'll bring you all of that news on Monday. Hugh for Hillsdale.com for all things Hillsdale.
Thanks for listening to the Hillsdale Dialogues, part of the Hillsdale College Podcast Network. More episodes at podcast.hillsdale.edu or wherever you find your audio. For more information about Hillsdale College, head to hillsdale.edu.